The stories were actually pretty scary. I don't like to be afraid of things like that, so it did kind of scare me a bit, so that's kind of saying something. However, I'm going to read some more. I don't know if these ones will be as scary. I've kind of glanced at them, but I'm going to read them. It's from Reddit Scary Encounters 2021. So, the first one I'm going to read is the Alaska Triangle, because it kind of sounds like the Bermuda Triangle or Dragon's Triangle, which I find to be very interesting. So, this one's a bit shorter. The Alaska Triangle. Why it's creepy. Encompassing an area ranging from near Juneau in the southeast to the northern Barrow region, to the western metropolis of Anchorage, Alaska's answer to the Bermuda Triangle, is comprised some of the most barren wilderness in the U.S., and it apparently craves souls. More than 20,000 people have gone missing without a trace in the area during the past half century alone. Are they being consumed by mythological beings like the beastly Keelut, which I've never heard of? It's spelled K-E-E-L-U-T, or the ghoulish kidnapper Kualupalek, which I think I've heard of in the last video I did. It's spelled Q-A-L-U-P-A-L-I-K. Lost on extreme hikes or simply vanishing into a dark vortex. Nobody knows, though it's not for lack of trying. When the government lost House Majority Leader Hale Boggs' Cessna to Triangle in 1972, a massive search turned up tons of conspiracy theories, but no bodies. Where it came from, the area has been associated with evil spirits and tinglet lore for centuries. Attributed trickster demons for luring people to an icy death, others believe the area exists amid an electromagnetically influenced vile vortex. I do think it has to do with some kind of electromagnetic thing, personally. But this says still others think it's a Darwinian result of explorers taking on nature. Regardless, the area continues to claim people, and underneath that massive blanket of snow and rock likely lies one of the largest and best preserved mass graves in the world. So that's interesting. That is the one that's a shorter one. Another one that I haven't read. Illinois, the Italian Bride. I live kind of close by Illinois, so this is interesting for me. Why it's creepy. An elaborate marble statue of a woman in a wedding dress is bound to stand out in a cemetery as it is, but that's not what's driven the Italian Bride to be a subject of local fascination. Upon closer inspection, there is an actual photo plaque on the gravesite of a woman in a casket, looking perfectly preserved, even though, as an inscription notes, the photo was taken 6 years after burial, after the body was exhumed. Reports of unusual activity cover everything from the smell of fresh flowers near the gravesite in the dead of winter to the ghostly figure of a woman in white roaming the cemetery or the halls of nearby Proviso West High School in the dead of night. Where it came from, in 1921, recently married Julia Bukula Petta died in childbirth and was buried in her wedding dress. Legend has it her mother immediately began experiencing nightmares that Julia was demanding her grave be reopened. The source of the distress varies depending on the storyteller, often relating to some sort is called the creature that lives in the woods. So it was a cool summer night, so me and my friends decided to camp out in the woods behind my house. I was looking for a house to rent or buy, and I ended up moving to a rural town after having a fight with my family. The house was nice and small on the edge of the town near a huge forest spanning at least 5 miles. So when I saw it was only a minute walk from my house, I was too excited because I always loved to camp out in the woods. Now this town was the type of place where everyone knew each other and almost seemed as if everyone was friends. So obviously when they found out another person was moving in, most came to greet me and bring me some gifts. You know, the classic pie and other baked goods. And when they all left, I was sitting on my front porch and felt a strange feeling like I was being watched. But I didn't know where from until I looked into the woods. When I looked at the woods, I saw a creature, a huge creature, at least 6 foot plus, standing up next to a tree. But it wasn't the height that scared me. It was its face. It looked like it wasn't even there. All I saw was its red glowing eyes staring back at me. I flinched back and ran, and it ran back into the woods. Now, I thought it was a prank at first because everyone knew I was moving in, so I figured it was just some teenager trying to pull a prank on the new person in the town. But just to be sure, I decided to go to the local store and buy some security cameras. And when I got there, it was only me and the cashier in the store. So I told them I was looking for some cameras because I saw some strange creature in the woods and I wanted to camp out, but not sure if it's safe, you know. Then when I looked back at him, his eyes were wide as I've ever seen, and he said to me, "You moved into the small cabin next to the woods, didn't you?" And before I could say anything, the small radio in the corner of his desk went off. Two teenagers found in the woods last night dead at their camping site. Update on the situation's coming soon. He then looked at me with the expression of, "Good luck, I don't know how you're gonna get out of this situation." And led me to the back and handed me 4 cameras and a small rifle. When I got back to my house, there was at least 6 to 7 people near the edge of the woods transporting what looked like 2 body bags out of the woods. "Great," I said. "I'd rather be fighting with my mom than having to deal with some mythical beast, but I had to deal with it some way or another." whistling in the woods. Hundreds of creatures whistling. They know I'm here. It's only a matter of time before they find me. That's a little creepy. Not as creepy as the other one. Okay, how about... let's see what the Idaho... the Phantom Jogger of Canyon Hill. So, Idaho... why it's creepy. There are rumors of many hauntings in Caldwell, Idaho's centuries-old Canyon Hill Cemetery. But the one that gets the most attention is the Midnight Jogger. As with many of the best urban legends, you can have to do your part to get her attention. In this case, it involves parking between certain trees in the cemetery at night. Do it right, and the legless apparition will knock on your window to let you know she's there, then continue on her route. It's creepy as hell, though now it's only the second worst image conjured when you think of sinister joggers. Where it came from, the origins are unknown, though considering there's another conspiratorial legend that the entire state of Idaho doesn't actually exist. Never heard that before. Perhaps the jogger is just a creation of a deranged and deceptive government. I've never heard that before. That's interesting. A lot of conspiracy theories here. Let's see what this one is. Hawaii, the night marchers. Why it's creepy. Picture yourself on a scenic Hawaiian beach at night. Imagine a full moon and a cool breeze running across the sand. Dreamy, but if you hear state, but you see vast, vast land that really you wonder nobody could really occupy it. And unless if you get off and get into a town or a city, but there's a lot of land there where it's like, I don't think people could exist and there could be something there. I really do believe it. I've seen caves in the sides of the mountains and things as I was going through the mountains truck driving. So I really find that quite interesting. So let's do, what is that? I gotta find where it was. Colorado Riverdale Road. Okay, so why it's creepy for 11 horrifying miles. Riverdale Road near Thornton, Colorado is crammed with enough horrifying legends to bring even the bravest paranormal investigator to his knees. From a ghostly runner attacking parked cars on Joggers Hill, to various demons and even a phantom Camaro revving up and down the winding road. But the gates of hell seems the epicenter. The physical iron gates are now gone, but what remains is the partial shell of an old mansion where a madman supposedly burned his wife and children alive. Left behind are the barren, charred plot of land and a white-clad woman who wanders the area. She's joined by the ghosts of slaves supposedly hanged from the now charred tree. Go ahead and run away when you see something creepy like an ethereal pack of dogs. You're probably just going to bump into something worse. Possibly hell, a portal to which some believe is here. That maybe explains why so many demons were conjured in a weird underground chicken coop near a set of underground tunnels where it came from. It's unknown when things got really hairy. Though given the spirits of ghosts and slaves, it's safe to assume that terrible things have been happening on Riverdale Road since the 1850s, and each time something terrible happened over the decades, it's just kind of got stacked onto this nesting doll of a horror show. Yeah. Okay, Connecticut. This one says why it's creepy, often cited as a dark vortex. Rumor has it that any visitor that steals an artifact from Dudley Town will have a curse put on them and their family. Dudley Town Forest visitors report seeing just about every kind of paranormal phenomena you could think of. People describe an unnerving lack of wildlife in the area, as well as floating orbs of light and sinister wolf-like black shadows. Murmurs and disembodied voices, as well as a feeling of general dread. And on the fact that there's a mysterious group called the Dark Forest Association that policies the grounds with militant force, and you've got yourself a serious case of what the hell is really going on here. Where it came from, the curse of the ill-fated Dudleys began back in jolly old England, where Edmund Dudley was beheaded for conspiring against King Henry the VII, I think it. This treacherous act apparently unleashed a curse on the rest of Dudley clan, which immigrated from Guildford, England to Cornwall, Connecticut in 1748. They helped establish a community center around the town's then thriving iron industry before a series of untimely disasters befell the family. Kentucky. I found one about Alabama. I used to go to Alabama, Madison, Alabama, and areas surrounding it a lot when I worked for a certain trucking company. I really like Alabama, but Alabama has a pretty, you know, big history as Kentucky. Interesting. Okay, so there's one about a long haul truck stop. So let's see what this one is. Oh, Huntsville. That I used to. Huntsville and Madison are right next to each other. So we're actually going to read this one. It's a little bit longer, but not too long. Okay, so this one is The Legend of Alabama's Dead Children's Playground. Adjoining Huntsville's historic Maple Hill Cemetery is a playground that looks much like any other. Featuring a modern swing set and climbing apparatus. But this playground isn't like others. Passersby often say they can see the swings moving on their own volition, as well as orbs or spectral figures. The playground is surrounded on three sides by limestone that formed many caves in this area, giving it a shroud. Giving it a shadowed appearance that lends itself to a spooky legends. The proximity to the historic cemetery doesn't hurt. Local teens call it the Dead Children's Playground, a macabre name for a place still used by families. So how did the innocent place get its gruesome name? According to legend, many children who died in Huntsville. I can't believe that because I actually delivered to Huntsville in Madison, Alabama a lot about 2 years ago, maybe now. 1.5 maybe, before my daughter. So that's interesting. I wish I could have stopped over here. So, according to the legend, many children who died in Huntsville during the 1918 Spanish flu pandemic are buried in Maple Hill plots adjoining the playground. The spirits of those children, some say, come out after dark to run and play as they might have in life. An online search turns up photos of unexplained shadows and orbs. It is true, many children as well as adults died during the worldwide pandemic, which killed an estimated 50 million people worldwide and hit Huntsville particularly hard. Hospital beds were filled and doctors were working long shifts in hope of easing some of the patients' misery. Many patients were treated at home with large quarantine signs on the doors, a practice which resulted in the disease spreading through entire families. Bodies were often stacked on wagons and hauled to morgues by horses. To try to prevent spread of the disease, parents cautioned children to leave their windows closed. This sing-song rhyme was a reminder. I had a bird, its name was Enza. I opened the window and influenza. Never heard that before. I had a bird, its name was Enza. I opened the window and influenza. Wow. According to the Alabama Department of Public Health, the deadly flu arrived in Alabama. desperate situation exists in Huntsville growing out of the Spanish influenza epidemic. All druggists, physicians, and prescription clerks except one have been stricken with the disease. And a distressing appeal reached Montgomery last night in telegrams for immediate help for the stricken city. Although there is no official count of the number of children who died in Huntsville during the pandemic or how many have been buried in Maple Hill, the number must have been in the hundreds. Very, very interesting, especially since I used to go there a lot. If any of you are from around there, let me know. Okay, this one's called the Phantom Truck Stop. Stories, you know, from truckers of stuff. I've never seen anything too much myself. But, this one's pretty long. Let me see if I can find one. To what I encountered rooms were unkempt and had enough graffiti on the walls to classify itself as an inner city truck stop. Even though I was practically in the middle of nowhere, it was also a small shop with a parking for only a dozen trucks. After washing up, I purchased a new work knife, some hot food, and headed out to my truck. I sat in the captain's chair and listened to the radio while I ate my dinner, with the windows down, letting in the dry wind. The Mississippi River had just begun flooding, but there hadn't been any rain in over a week. The surrounding area was beginning to look like Nevada, more than Arkansas. I finished my meal and cleaned up a bit. I slid out of the seat and onto the pavement as a gust of warm wind hit me. I strolled over to the dumpster, tossed my garbage inside, and began slowly walking back to my truck. I fished out a filterless cigarette and leaned against the bug-splattered side of my truck and lit it with my lighter. Certain areas, you get a lot of bugs on your windows, and it's gross. Changed into a pair of pajamas and laid down to get some rest. I didn't bother setting an alarm. I felt sleep creep over me and accepted it as I drifted into dream world. Jolted awake. I awoke with the cab of the truck rocking violently, knocking the bottle of water I had placed on my nightstand over onto the floor. I sat straight up, fully awake, and pressed the bottom of the truck's radio alarm. It was shortly after 3 in the morning. I reached down and grabbed the bottle of water that had fallen, twisted the cap off, and took a few deep gulps before wondering what had rocked my truck so violently. Then I remembered the wind. I settled back down, got my heart rate down, back down below 100, and lay my head down on the pillow. The truck rocked again, knocking my ashtray over that I had set up in the cup holder. Once again, tossing my water bottle onto the floor. stealing myself for what was going to be, stealing myself for what was going to be an uncomfortable encounter at the least. I took a step up on the ferry and leaned my head into the truck. "Is anyone in here?" I asked. I hit the switch to turn on the sleeper breath light. I climbed in. I put a knee on the seat and peered into the sleeper breath. "Good night," a soft voice said, which seemed to emanate from all around me. I flinched as I heard the word and felt a cold chill run through my body. I slid off the seat and stood up in the cab, bumping my temple off of the overhead storage bins. I looked around the sleeper. No one was there. Something inhuman. I turned around and shuffled into the cab to close the door when I saw the young girl standing outside my truck on the pavement, looking up at me with lifeless eyes. Those eyes, you see, weren't meant for a person. They were designed for a predator. Sudden, I felt like prey. I reached forward and slammed the door shut and flicked the lock. I quickly decided that I was not staying here for the rest of the night. I turned the key and heard my truck's motor rumble to life, along with the familiar, annoying buzzing. That was my air pressure gauge telling me that I didn't have enough air to release the brakes. I took a furtive glance out the window, and there she was, stood, still as a tree, looking up at me and smiling. I didn't want to get any closer to the window until I was ready to get my truck moving. This was wrong, and I didn't want any part of this. That girl wasn't human, at least not anymore. She wasn't. It was almost as if she was something so inhuman that it would take the form of a human. It's hard for me to explain, and I feel sick just thinking about it. I heard the siren shut off and hit the valves to supply air to my brake system. As the system began to air up, the siren came on again. "Screw this," I thought to myself. "I have enough to get out of here." I disengaged the clutch, ground the truck into gear, and roared out of the parking lot like the devil himself was behind me, for which of all I knew he was. I looked in my side mirror, and I was about to start turning right and saw the girl washed in the red and amber glow of running lights. She was smiling at me and waving. I flew my gears as quickly as they would let me as I got back onto the interstate. The knife and the postcard. I drove for about 45 minutes, repeatedly hitting the switch to turn on my interior lights to look around the cab and the sleeper, before finally spotting a larger truck stop at the next exit. After backing into one of the few remaining spots left, I shut off my lights and turned on the sleeper breath light as I walked into the back, then paused. At the store, I had bought a souvenir, nothing fancy, just a postcard with a picture of Arkansas on it. I also had bought a new knife. I had never even taken the knife out of the box and remembered putting the postcard into a drawer for safekeeping. The point of the blade had been driven directly into the spot on I-40, where I had originally stopped for the night. The blade had been driven in deep, pegging the postcard to my nightstand. It took me several minutes just to